is awaiting the 129th running of the Preakness Stakes. Hi, everybody. I'm Bob Costas. Included in today's field of 10 are contenders like Lionheart and Imperialism, who ran second and third in the Kentucky Derby, plus well-regarded newcomers Eddington and Rock Hard 10, who weren't in the Derby field. But in the build-up to this Preakness, they all play supporting roles to racing's current marquee star, Smarty Jones. Philadelphia's favorite is now the people's choice overall, and what a choice, currently being held at 2-5. Now, racing experts see potential greatness in Smarty Jones, and the public fascination with this horse has been building over the past 2 weeks, ever since he ran his record to a perfect 7 wins in 7 starts at the Derby.
Strongest storm yet.
Are we getting some vicious weather now?
Winds of 40 to 50 miles per hour.
There is a flash flood warning.
Storm rolls across Churchill Downs.
Bolts of lightning here and there around the area.
Be advised, line of storm going right through the Louisville area now.
Brace yourselves.
This is a real mess on the track right now. Thunder is rolling through Churchill Downs.
Philadelphia has been forever identified with the underdog, maybe because they feel like as a city they've always been the underdog. This horse, Smarty Jones, he's really the ultimate Philadelphia story. He's Rocky. To have this horse get to the Derby was an astonishing story. Like 20 years of losing was just lifted off this city. I think people really identify with Smarty Jones because of that.
Smarty Jones is the greatest horse in the history of Philadelphia.
You would think like he was like the McNabb of horse races or something.
He's a Philly horse, native Philly horse. Who ever expected him to win?
Welcome to Philadelphia Park for this Monday, May the 3rd. Future windows are open. Let us now review the changes on this afternoon's 10 race card.
I think I'm still dreaming. You know, every morning I wake up, I think about that. I think, geez, I won the Kentucky Derby. To come back here and see the reception kind of caught me by surprise, because I can't tell you how many times I heard that horse is from Philadelphia, he can't be that good. He's made believers out of everybody. I got marks all up and down my side where I've been pinching myself just to make sure that I'm still awake, you know, this isn't a dream.
Today, the dreams of a city look 2 hours south to Baltimore, to Pimlico, the Preakness Stakes, the second stop on the journey to immortality. Only one still has a chance to write another chapter in this Philadelphia story. Pimlico Race Course in Baltimore, where, yes, it's another Smarty party. It's Preakness Day, Maryland's day to shine, with crab cakes and other Chesapeake Bay delicacies vying for attention with glamorous outfits. The rowdy infield party is well underway. No puddles to frolic in like 2 weeks ago, at least not yet. And at Philadelphia Park, here's a live shot from the second floor. The Philly faithful have turned out to watch and wager on their newest sports hero. Here at Pimlico, where racing has been held since 1870, the crowd is well over 100,000, likely the largest to ever witness a sporting event in the state of Maryland. They're here to see the newest star in the American sports galaxy continue his quest to become the first Visa Triple Crown winner in 26 years. And a short time ago, Smarty Jones owners Pat and Chappie Chapman arriving here at Pimlico for the big day. Chappie, who has emphysema, confined to a wheelchair, getting the ride in the golf cart, and all things are go for Smarty at the Preakness. Preakness Day in Baltimore is a hot one. The temperature has been in the 80s all week long leading up to this day. 86 degrees as post time approaches. There is a chance that there might be some thunderstorms later in the afternoon, about race time as a matter of fact, but right now the track is fast. Hello everyone, I'm Tom Hammond, and welcome to Old Hilltop, Pimlico, and the 2004 Preakness Stakes. It's a day filled with anticipation as Smarty Jones attempts to keep his perfect record intact. The little horse from the wrong side of the tracks, 7-for-7, he could join some elite company today in history. Only two horses, Seattle Slew and Majestic Prince, have won the Derby and Preakness while undefeated. But to win today, Smarty will have to face rivals from the Derby, including Lionheart and Imperialism, who finished second and third, plus two new horses, Rock Hard 10 and Eddington, excluded from the Derby for lack of graded earnings, but talented and ready for a shot at Smarty Jones. 10 go to the post. The betting opened yesterday. You see the current odds, including Smarty Jones, the heavy favorite, at 2-5. Imperialism, the second choice, at 6-1. And joined now by Chelsea Candy. And Chelsea, the lives of the Chapmans, of John Service and Stuart Elliott, changed forever when he crossed the finish line at Churchill Downs 2 weeks ago. And when he returned to Philadelphia Park, his home base, 5,000 people turned out to see him gallop. But gallop there is the operative word, because he has not had a breeze, a timed workout, since the Derby. Is that unusual?
Well, for most horses, maybe. But for Smarty Jones, believe me, he gets enough out of his morning workouts. His actual breezes are pretty sporadic. Right. He's only had three published workouts since he made his seasonal debut in February. But if you watch him gallop in the mornings, believe me, he is so tough. He's got a 160-pound exercise boy, Peter Van Trump, there you see him, and he's got him straight as a string. Look at him. He really gallops right along what we call a two-minute lick, which is faster than an open gallop. So that kind of takes the place of his workouts.
You can see him there, his neck bowed, ready to go. Will he be hard to handle in this race today because he's so full of energy?
Well, John Service takes him with the pony most mornings and kind of contains him, and he said he wanted to have him fighting mad. He wanted him to have a big head of steam. The risk is he might be a little too strong going into the first turn, and he'll be chasing Lionheart and Sir Shackleton, who are the big speed. They want him to relax and sit off him, just like he did in the Kentucky Derby.
Well, as we said, it's a mix of new faces and old rivals that Smarty will face today, and for all of that, let's go to Mike Battaglia and Bob Neumeier.
Well, thanks, Tom. It's a daunting task to win this Triple Crown. Three races, five short weeks, three different racetracks. You got to be good, yep. And you got to be lucky. And to be lucky is to be healthy in this game. And the Cliff's Edge, not so fortunate.
Yeah, one of the horses that didn't make it, the Cliff's Edge, this is a horse that was peaking at just the right time. I mean, he wins the Bluegrass impressively. He looks to be a major factor in the Triple Crown races. And then a few strides out of the gate in the Kentucky Derby, something happens that not only kills his chances to win the Derby, it also knocks him out of this race this afternoon, the Preakness. If you take a look at the highlighted area there, the Cliff's Edge, his left front, you can see that this is right out of the gate. His shoe is already hanging off the side of his foot. He takes about four more strides. See the shoe still hanging there, hitting very erratically. Again, another stride. Now we're going to go forward a couple of frames. This is very hard to see, but watch the shoe. It finally falls off. Look in between the horse's legs in front of him, and you'll see the shoe just shoots off to his left. He's without a left front shoe already. I talked to Nick Zito about this. He said after this happened, the horse started favoring his right front. He wound up losing his right front shoe also. Now, without his two front shoes, he had no chance in the slop at Churchill Downs. So he not only lost all chance of winning there, he bruises his right foot. He gets knocked out of the Preakness here this afternoon. So we got the Cliff's Edge here today.
Well, if you want to win the Preakness, history tells us you got to run in the Derby. For the last 18 years, only one new face has won this race, not running in the Derby. And we have a couple of excellent new faces this year, including Rock Hard 10, who really had buzzard's luck in the Santa Anita Derby. He was second. He was disqualified to third. That $60,000 in purse money cost him a shot in the Kentucky Derby. And Eddington had lousy luck as well. In the Wood Memorial at New York at the Big A, that's him second from the rail. And he's going to duck in here and challenge Master David on the rail. Now Tappet's going to come zooming in the outside to win the race. Whoever finished second here would have made the Derby by purse earnings. Master David on the inside, Eddington just one from the rail, and in this nose photograph, Master David beat Eddington for place money. That knocked Eddington out of the top 20 as well as Rock Hard 10. They're both excellent horses. They both deserve to be here.
And we got three more new shooters, too. We got Little Math Man, who's a late runner. We got Water Cannon, the Maryland Hope. This is a horse that's won five races in a row. Remember Magic Wisner? He came flying to get second at a big price. And we've got the Derby trial winner, Sir Shackleton, from the barn of Nick Zito. He lost the Cliff's Edge. He's got Sir Shackleton here this afternoon.
But history tells us if you're a new shooter, you're up against it in the Preakness. Let's go to Don.
With his natural speed, Lionheart has the ability to affect the complexion of the Preakness more than any other horse in the race. And by trainer Patrick Biancone's own choosing, he's chosen the number one post position. There's an old racing adage here in Maryland that says, at Pimlico, speed in the rail always has an advantage, but there's a lot of modern-day handicappers who say it's just no longer the case, and in fact, some people say it never was. I called on Chris McCarron. He's a former jockey, a Hall of Fame rider who dominated racing here in the mid-70s. He won six Triple Crown races, including two Preaknesses. And Chris, I would love to hear your opinion. Is speed in the rail an advantage to Pimlico?
It certainly can be. If you're the best horse, it's the shortest way home. And if you can get the lead and get to the fence, shortest way home, you have a big advantage. But Lionheart has a habit of running away from the rail a little bit. He likes to drift out as he runs. And I've noticed that Mike Smith, who's riding him, doesn't necessarily fight him. He likes to let him race out off the fence a little bit. So he may not get the shortest way home. But I think it's a misconception that speed, this Pimlico is a speed bias racetrack. I won a lot of races back here from 1974 to 1978 by taking horses back and making a late run. When I moved to California, I had to adjust my style and learn how to be a speed rider. I think it's a very unbiased racetrack.
How do you think Pimlico managed to earn this reputation?
That's a good question. Probably from the gamblers.
Yeah, you're right. A lot of misconceptions come from the gamblers. We go to Kenny Rice. Thank you, Chris.
You're welcome.
Thanks, Donna. And why would a guy bring a horse here who is coming off a 10th place finish in the Kentucky Derby, 16 and a quarter lengths behind Smarty Jones, his worst career showing in eight starts? Well, trainer Bo Greeley is not giving up on Borrego, that 10th place Derby horse. He said he's overlooking the Derby, and instead right now he has been reviewing the Arkansas Derby, where Borrego was a closing second, just a length and a half behind Smarty Jones. I talked with Greeley this morning. He said two other factors played in there. Borrego generally is a horse that does not like to train, but on the Monday after the Derby, when he took him out for a routine jog, he almost broke into a full gallop. And then this past Monday at Churchill Downs, in his final big tune-up for this race, he had what Greeley said might have been the best workout of his career. But Greeley also said, and these are his words, by the end of this day, I could either look like a genius or an idiot. He certainly isn't bucking history here, though. In the last 18 years, three horses have finished 10th or worse in the Kentucky Derby. Snow Chief, Hansel, and most recently Louis Couture's. And then 2 weeks later, they were able to turn it around and come in here and win the Preakness. And Greeley also said he thinks he has one other thing in his favor. He was out on the track this morning. He thinks the track is a little deeper than it usually is on Preakness Day. So he thinks that it sets up a lot better today for a closer than some of the speed horses in this race, Tom.
All right, Kenny. Meanwhile, here's the horse they're all trying to beat. It's Smarty Jones, very calm a few moments ago, awaiting his call for the Preakness, second jewel in the Visa Triple Crown. Look at downtown Baltimore in the distance, and our aerial coverage today courtesy of the Goodyear Tire and Rubber Company and its fleet of airships, reminding you to travel with peace of mind on Goodyear's new Assurance tires. Let's check the odds for you now. Smarty Jones has been a very heavy favorite since the betting opened. A lot of folks probably made that trip down I-95 from Philadelphia. Lionheart 7-1, Borrego at 14, Little Math Man, Song of the Sword, and Sir Shackleton are long shots. Smarty Jones now 1-2. Imperialism at 6-1. Eddington 15. Rock Hard 10 8-1. And Water Cannon is 40-1. And we invite you to log on to NBCSports.com for pre- and post-race coverage of the Preakness. There's analysis from Bob Neumeier, tips on handicapping the field, and a web replay of the race. All of that is at NBCSports.com. You can also cast your vote for who you think will win the Preakness. 21-year-old trainer Kristen Mulhall brings Imperialism to the Preakness after a troubled third in the Derby. If you look closely at Imperialism's eyes, you'll notice that his left eye is normal, But the right eye is sunken, which limits his vision on that side. That's sometimes a factor in his races. And we sat down with Kristen to watch Imperialism in the Derby.
Any problem in the gate with that right eye?
Not really. He's pretty good in the gate. He knows exactly. He'll get a little impatient. He knows how to, if he has to stand too long. That's why we picked the outside post.
Uh-huh. Now, when we watched this replay, what was the most distressing part of the Derby for you? What was the scariest part for you as you watched this isolated replay?
Well, the first part of the race when he passed the wire first time around and he got clipped, I saw that in the race and I was just hoping he was okay. I was worried about him all the way around there. Action this day clipped him right up, took pretty good size of, quite a bit of hair off of right above his hock. It could have been pretty ugly, but we were lucky. But then when he couldn't get through, if he could have been on the outside where Tappet was when Tappet made up all that ground, I think he would have been right up there. He's the kind of horse that makes a huge, starts moving a little at the half mile pole and he makes right there.
Mm-hmm.
Makes a huge 3/8 of a mile run, and I think if he could have been out there, he would have been right there.
And basically it's just racing luck, because Kent really didn't have a whole lot of options, did he?
He had no options.
How much difference do you think it would have made? Could he have beaten Smarty Jones?
I don't know if he would have beaten Smarty Jones. My horse is a really game horse when he's head-to-head. He showed it in the San Rafael when he beat Lionheart. So he would have given all he has. I think he definitely would have been second. I think he would have been right on the side of Smarty Jones. What Smarty Jones had left in his tank, I don't know. But he looks like a really nice horse.
He does.
And Imperialism. Watch Kent DeSorbo. He crosses the finish line and puts his fist down in disgust, even though he ran third. But apparently the key for Imperialism is keeping him on the outside. When he's inside horses, he sort of cocks his head to the side for a full range of vision from his good left eye, and perhaps not with full focus on running. After the Derby, Kristen said she was thrilled to be third, but Kent DeSorma was really angry about his bad trip and eventually helped convince Kristen to come here to the Preakness. And stabled here at Pimlico, take a look at which horses are side-by-side in the Preakness barn. Imperialism and Rock Hard 10, two California horses who have a history in the Santa Anita Derby. In the closing strides of that race, Rock Hard 10 with Castledale on his outside, Imperialism at the rail, comes over on Imperialism, checks right there. Rock Hard 10 disqualified from second to third, and the difference in that money kept him out of the Kentucky Derby. Well, David Flores rode Rock Hard 10 that day, but Gary Stevens had ridden him in his other two starts. Stevens has flown from France to be aboard today. Right now, he's with Bob Costas.
All right, Tom, thanks very much. Gary Stevens has, in fact, won the Preakness twice. You must think that Rock Hard 10 has an excellent chance to make this grueling trip back and forth.
I think he's a special horse. He's lacking on education-wise right now, but he's an athlete. He's a great mover, and he takes his education very well. So I also have a lot of belief in his trainer, Jace Norman's a close friend of mine, and the family. They've put a lot into the sport and going to be around for a long time. So I feel like I'm part of the team, and I want to be definitely a part of Rock Hard 10's team.
Quickly, your itinerary, Friday through Sunday. People won't believe it.
Well, I arrived from France yesterday at noon. Riding today, I've got a flight out of D.C. tonight at 10:15. I arrive at Charles de Gaulle at 11:30 tomorrow morning. I'll be at Longchamp Racecourse in Paris, racing at 2 o'clock tomorrow. We've got the 2,000 guineas in France tomorrow, so a pretty hectic schedule.
How is the track playing today?
It's not favoring speed. Yesterday and today, the place to be is not on the lead, but a lot of times you can overdo it. If there's a very slow pace, I mean, I don't know what's going to happen out there, but I'm not gonna break my horse in two to try and keep him off the lead. If nobody wants it, I'll take it to them.
Well, Rock Hard 10, generally, short career, three races, but generally a horse that likes to run on the lead, so does Smarty Jones. Do you figure to have Smarty Jones in your sights throughout?
Yeah, I'll have him in my sights. I've got a lot of respect for him. I saw the Derby, and he's got a lot of quality. We've got our work cut out for him, but that's what these big races are about. They've got to get through it every time. He had a grueling race 2 weeks ago, and my horse is fresh, but again, he's lacking in seasoning. So I'm going to be very leery of him, but I'll know where he's at.
How are you doing since that horrific accident last summer at the Arlington Million?
Took a lot of time to get totally healed up. I started back a little bit early and got through the Breeders' Cup and took a couple months off, and going to France right now, I'm probably fitter and healthier than I've been for a long time. And you know, it was a jolt to me, to my system, and my brain a little bit. But it's probably one of the best things that's ever happened in my life. I'm enjoying life every day that I get up, and I'm enjoying the racing, and things are good in Gary Stevens' life right now.
And the last thing, you played George Wolfe, as most people know, in the Seabiscuit movie, stepped in for Red Pollard, George Wolfe did, in the match race at Pimlico between War Admiral and Seabiscuit in 1938. Even though the scenes were shot elsewhere, does that give you even more of a connection to this course?
Yeah, I think so. I've always been fond of Pimlico. It's been very good to me. I've won the Pimlico Special a couple of times, which is what the match race originated from, is the Pimlico Special. So, you know, I feel a lot of different bonds in different categories from the shooting of Seabiscuit. But it's good to be here, and I feel at home here.
Good luck today, Gary.
Thanks, Bob.
All right, let's go back to Tom Hammond.
All right, Bob, and there's Rockhart 10. He's a beautiful horse, huge horse, over 17 hands in measurement, and Rockhart 10 at 7-1 currently, and it's a measure of how much respect Gary Stevens has for him that he would make that transatlantic trip.
Well, the horse has only run three times, and it's very hard to know what his running style is going to be off of so few starts. So when Gary was asked what his strategy would be, he said he was going to subscribe to the late, great Bill Shoemaker's theory. Get him out of the gate, and then get out of his way.
All right. That's Rockhart 10, one of the rivals for Smarty Jones today in the 129th running of the Preakness Stakes, second jewel in the Visa Triple Crown. We're coming your way from Pimlico in Baltimore. Jam-packed Pimlico Racecourse in Baltimore for the 129th Preakness Stakes. A look at the infield. They're packed in there today. We think it's the largest crowd who ever witnessed a sporting event in Maryland. Meanwhile, up I-95 at Philadelphia Park, Philadelphians are turning out to wager on Smarty Jones. You see the sign in the background there. At the Derby at Philadelphia Park, they bet $2.7 million on the race, and almost a million of it was bet on Smarty Jones. And thinking back about the Smarty Jones Derby victory, there may have been some divine intervention. John Service, the trainer of Smarty Jones, has a sister who is a nun, a Dominican order in the outskirts of Philadelphia. And she went to the OTB with 17 envelopes filled with money from the sisters to bet on Smarty Jones at the Derby. When she went back, she took some help so that each bet could have the money stuffed in the envelope by another one of the sisters. But at the convent, they're all watching Smarty Jones today, and I'm sure they've been back to the windows.
And just to double up on the good luck stuff, Pat Chapman gave John Service a religious medal at the Kentucky Derby to put under Smarty Jones' saddle towel. Obviously, it worked, but in the aftermath, the excitement in the winner's circle, John forgot about it, and it fell off to the ground, and his neighbor, fortunately, was there, thought it was a rose petal and salvaged it, so I'm sure it will be finding its way around Pimlico Racecourse under Smarty's saddle today.
And the funny part about the sisters at the convent, they didn't realize that place and show tickets were also good, and they tore a couple of them up before someone said, no, you can also cash those on Smarty Jones. There's so many angles to the Smarty Jones story. The horse who reared in the gate last year, fracturing his skull, nearly losing his eye, put in the care of a trainer and jockey who'd never competed in a Triple Crown race. The trainer demonstrating his loyalty by sticking with his rider. The name, the underdog status, the filly connection. It's a feel-good story that ironically began with a tragedy.
We were getting out of our car in the garage and I answered the phone. Our old barn manager from our farm had called to say she had just heard that Bob had been murdered.
His name is Wade Matthew Russell, 36 years old, the stepson of Bob Kamak. The well-known Delaware Valley horse trainer and his wife, Mary Ann, were found dead yesterday morning at their Salem County horse farm.
We were very close to Bob, and we were devastated. Weren't sure we wanted to go on with racing.
We were going to get out of racing, I think. Because I said, I've had enough. I don't want to go through another trainer.
Well, I knew about that the day it happened. I mean, you know, Bobby was a good friend of mine, and I respected him very much as a horseman. I tell you, it was a very, very somber place around here for a long time. It really hurt Philadelphia Park. I was fortunate to be the recipient of a tragic situation.
A tragic situation, one that makes you reevaluate your direction. A stable that was once flush with dozens of horses had now been pared to just two. But from tragedy often comes triumph.
And one of the horses they decided to keep was the one with which they felt a sentimental connection.
Smarty was born on February the 28th, 2001, and that was my mother's birthday. And I said to Chappie, I'd really like to name this horse after my mother, and we played around with different names, and we didn't want to name him Mildred, so didn't think that would be fair. So I said, let's call this horse Smarty Jones, and Chappie said, I like that name.
And let me say this honestly, we never dreamt that we would get into the Kentucky Derby. We just didn't dream it.
And here's the first undefeated winner of the Kentucky Derby, 1977.
He came running down that stretch. I mean, I exploded. You saw me. Most of my friends thought I had a heart attack. I didn't have a heart attack. I couldn't get my breath, so I had to sit down.
Hey, you want to sit down for a minute? Sit down, Chappie. Sit down. Just take a breath.
It's a feeling nobody can describe to you. Unless you've been in the horse business, everybody dreams of getting to the Kentucky Derby. And then all of a sudden, along came Smarty, so here we are.
And here they are at Pimlico. John Service, the trainer, who said he didn't want to go to the Kentucky Derby until he had a horse that could win it. And he said, my knees might buckle when I walk over and see those twin spires. He's handled it all with grace and class, and they're easy to root for, this Smarty Jones group. And of course, as we've gotten to know them over the last couple of weeks, they certainly are rooting for the little guy. They're representing all of their compatriots back at Philadelphia Park, and for the guys that toil with only a dream for all those years and then finally see that dream come true. It certainly came true for Stuart Elliott, the jockey. He'll be sitting on that saddle cloth on Smarty Jones. There's Stuart gathering his thoughts. He had a flawless ride to win the Derby. Venerable Pimlico Race Course, the second oldest race course in America behind only Saratoga, scene of the 129th running of the Preakness Stakes today on a hot afternoon in Baltimore. Let's recheck the odds. 7-1 Lionheart, Borrego at 14, Little Math Man, Song of the Sword, and Sir Shackleton again continuous long shots. Smarty Jones still at 1-2. That hasn't changed since the last time we checked. Imperialism 6-1, Eddington 14, Rockhard 10, 7-1. He's starting to get some play now. He's fallen from 10 when we came on the air, and Water Cannon is 35-1. And live shot from the jocks room here at Pimlico. Stuart Elliott will have the mount on Smarty Jones. It'll be his first ride in the Preakness Stakes, as it was his first ride in the Kentucky Derby. The best jockeys are amongst the highest paid athletes in the world, but for every millionaire, there are dozens at the other end of the economic spectrum grinding out a tough living at small tracks across the country. To be a jockey requires a lot more than just being small in stature.
I was born to be a rider. My father rode. Both my grandparents owned horses, and my uncle, who actually taught me how to ride, was a trainer.
When I was about 12 years old, I decided that this is what I wanted to do. When you get on that horse and you go out there to ride a race, you keep dreaming of those big races.
This is a dream shared by a journeyman rider at Philadelphia Park and by a two-time Eclipse-winning Hall of Fame jockey.
Mike Smith asked her for a run, and in an instant, the response was devastating.
I can't honestly describe what it feels like to win a race of the importance of the Preakness, or you know, the Kentucky Derby, or the Belmont, or any Breeders' Cup races. It's a high that's there's no higher.
Churchill Downs, the first Saturday in May. For Stuart Elliott, his first quest for the Blanket of Roses. But both newcomer and Derby veteran understand the pain and struggles required to be a part of history.
It's a dangerous sport. I've broke both collarbones a couple of times, actually. This one really bad, it kind of sticks out, you know. Back of this whole shoulder blade, this arm like three times. My back, my toes, my foot. my shin bone, maybe a finger here and there, thumb. That's about it, not too bad, really.
Pain is a way of life for a jockey, but it was this devastating fall at Saratoga that almost forced Mike Smith out of the game he loved.
I crushed T12 and L3, and hairline fractured a lot of other my vertebrae, and so I couldn't ride. You stay depressed, because you took me away from the action, you know, away from what I love to do. They said I had to be at least twice as strong as it was before. You're not going to be able to do this. It's a tough sport, you know, you're easy to be replaced. You just literally just get off and you put somebody else on.
This mindset compels many top riders to push their return to the track. And the weight, always the weight.
I started to get a little bit older. My body was trying to grow. Like, I started having some weight problems.
The son of a jockey, Elliot had witnessed firsthand the fight to maintain a competitive weight.
I watched my father almost kill himself. I'll never forget that. His eyes were like rolled back. He couldn't talk. He was like a vegetable.
With this memory etched in his mind, Stewart left the competitive riding world for over a year and a half.
It was hard. I was lost. I didn't really understand how much I enjoyed it until I couldn't do it. So one day I decided to start back and try to get the weight off, and things have worked out.
Following separate paths, searching for one dream. 2 weeks ago today, that dream became a reality for one and spelled heartbreak for the other.
As Lionheart turns for home, and undefeated Smarty Jones comes wide off the turn.
We were so close. You know, you go from thinking you're going to win until somebody passes. You want to talk about let the air out of your balloon. You know, I've been there, I've done it 3 times now, so got to win one of those one of these days.
No matter what happens, in the history books, it's a great feat. It's something that they can never take away from you.
And there they are live in the jocks room at Pimlico. Mike Smith on the right, Stewart Elliott on the left. Can you imagine Mike's thoughts on Lionheart trying to win the Derby so many times and seeing Stewart Elliott in his first Derby ride go by with Smarty Jones to take the roses? I've often thought, too, the jockeys really don't get their due as fantastic athletes. Not only does it take incredible strength to control those animals going about 35 miles an hour, but you have to have a sense of timing and tactics as well. In fact, Donna Barton Brothers has been watching this feature on the jockeys. She's our former jockey. Perhaps she has a comment. Donna?
Well, Tom, I do have a comment. The passion for the sport always overrides the pain in the jockey colony. I only rode for 11 and a half years, and in that short time, I had 6 concussions, broke my nose 5 times, had it operated on twice, broke my collarbone, broke a couple of ribs, cracked a few vertebrae, and I have a very short list of injuries compared to most jockeys in the jocks room. But you know what? This race here today, the Preakness Stakes, it's what it's all about, and this is what makes jockeys keep coming over the pain or overcoming the pain and coming back to try to win races like the Preakness and the Derby.
Ouch, Donna. You look pretty good to have been through all that. Here's a live shot. Smarty Jones, they're beginning to walk over. There's John Service. Smarty Jones, number 7. He's won 7 in a row. He's beginning to walk over to be saddled for the Preakness Stakes, the 129th edition from Pimlico. The aerial view of Pimlico. Most of the horses for the Preakness are saddled in one big stakes barn, and the call has gone out to come over for the Preakness, so the walkover has begun. And while we have the walkover, we'll give you an update of the odds at the bottom of your screen in our odds crawl. And there's a look at number 7, Smarty Jones, winner of the Derby and the heavy favorite in the Preakness. Smarty Jones making the walkover. A look at his ears. He's all attention here. And Bob Neumeier has been with Smarty Jones and John Service. Bob?
Well, thanks, Tom, and I'm with trainer John Service as we walk behind the big favorite for the Preakness. John, first of all, how has this whirlwind changed your life?
Well, a little tough getting up the horse path right now, I can tell you that. It's been great. Listen, I didn't realize how much support that I had for myself and my horse, and it's been a great feeling. I mean, I'm loving it.
I believe since early 80s that every winner of this race has had at least one workout between the Derby and the Preakness. You chose not to. Should people who back your horse be a little concerned about that?
Well, I just did what I thought was best for my horse, and if I did the wrong thing, I'm sure I won't be the first guy.
Before the Derby, Jerry Bailey was open, arguably the greatest rider in the world, and yet you stuck with Stewart Elliott. Was there ever a time you thought about making a switch to Bailey?
No.
And Stewart did the job for you in the Derby.
Stewart's my man.
Good luck.
Thank you very much.
Let's go to Kenny.
Okay, thanks, Bob. Of course, in Europe, it's very common for trainers to bring their horses in the day of a big race or just a few days out. And that suits Frenchman Patrick Biancone just perfect with his horse Lionheart, who will make his fifth start today on his fifth straight different track. But Patrick told me earlier this week that Lionheart is one of the smartest horses he had ever trained, so smart that it's better for him not to race over the same track that he trains because he gets used to where the poles are. And for example, he'll come to the 5/8 pole and figure, maybe I'll take a breeze. But I notice you got a cool towel on his head, Patrick, and we could all use one of those right now.
Yeah, it's warm today. I mean, we had the rain 2 weeks ago. Now we have a beautiful day, and we enjoy to be here, you know.
Your horse has been out 6 times, 3 wins, and 3 seconds. He has a running style that goes out there, as we saw in the Kentucky Derby, and says, come and get me. With the way the track is playing now, do you figure that will hold up again today, that speed?
I hope so. You know, his talent is his speed, and Mike Smith is riding beautifully all the time, and we just hope to have a clean trip and everything go well for everybody in the race.
Good luck today.
Thank you.
Back to Tom.
All right, Kenny, the walkover continuing as they come from the stakes barn. And, of course, you know the Preakness tradition probably. They saddle outdoors on the turf course so all can see. Let's go to Donna Brothers.
Tom, after Imperialism's third-place finish in the Kentucky Derby, he earned a ticket to the Preakness. But as we saw earlier in our clip, he had a very difficult trip in there, and who knows where he would have run with a clear trip. Kristen, you gallop this horse, you work him. Does it ever occur to you that you might like to ride him in a race sometime, especially this one?
I've always thought what the feeling would be, how much different he would be, but I'll leave that up to the riders.
Speaking of that, will you give King DeStormonian instructions, or do you just let him ride his race?
I just let him ride his race. He knows him. He knows the track better than anyone, and he'll do the best thing.
Kristen, good luck to you. And Tom, on the way up here, owner Stephen Taub is right here, and he said this is the most exciting sport and the most exciting day in racing.
Right. And Kristen was quite an equestrian herself. In fact, her dad, Richard Mulhall, who is not here today, he's home with a detached retina, said that he thought she would have made the U.S. Olympic team as a rider. There's a look at Imperialism, the gray horse. All those horses came from the Preakness barn, but there's one that took a different route to get there. That's the local Water Cannon, trained by Linda Albert, who's with Mike Battaglia.
You're right, Tom, and he took a long route because he isn't here yet. Linda's still here waiting for a horse. But, Linda, this has just got to be a special day. You're a regular here on the Maryland circuit, and now you've got a horse in the big race. He's won 5 races in a row. It's got to be a special feeling.
It is, and I think I'm going to have him well warmed up when he finally gets here.
That's a long walk. How far is it?
It seems like it's probably going to be about a mile, I would guess,
really?
Just doing the math.
How are you feeling now? Are you feeling nervous? Are you feeling excited?
Maybe a little nervous. It's just, you know, it's a long day. By the time you build up to the race is the easy part.
You've been quoted as saying that you're down to 10 horses right now. You've had some tough times in this business, and you thought about quitting. But a horse like this has to bring it all back together.
Sure. It really does make it all a lot more worthwhile when you show up in the morning for this.
What makes this horse so special?
5 wins in a row.
Yeah. I think he's 35-1, but you have confidence in him.
We think he's got a little bit of a shot.
All right, Linda, I hope he gets here.
And he's right behind us.
And guard, good luck.
Thanks.
Yeah, Mike, you can't see him, but Water Cannon is slowly but surely making his way over there to be saddled. Meanwhile, to document the 129th Preakness, the jockeys posing for the official jockeys photo. 10 riders lined up to record this moment, the 129th running of the Preakness Stakes. Well, only 5 horses, including Smarty Jones, have won the Kentucky Derby while undefeated. The last, Seattle Slew in 1977, en route to the Triple Crown. Before that, Majestic Prince had headed to the Preakness with a perfect record, and he's the subject of our Buick Preakness Stakes moment. In 1943, Johnny Longdon guided Count Fleet to a wire-to-wire 8-length victory in the Preakness on his way to the Triple Crown. 26 years later, in 1969, Longdon was the trainer of Majestic Prince, who came to the Preakness with an unblemished record after his win in the Derby. With Bill Hartack up, Majestic Prince held off Arts and Letters by a head, but Arts and Letters turned the tables at the Belmont, denying Majestic Prince the Triple Crown. Back at Pimlico, and we'd like to welcome the folks at the USA Network to NBC. NBC and USA now part of NBC Universal. And you'll be seeing plenty of coverage of the U.S. Olympic trials on the USA Network. And during the Olympic Games in Athens, USA Network will be your cable home for the Olympic Games from Greece. John Service putting the saddle on Smarty Jones, who continues to rule as the favorite. He's 3-5 at the moment. Smarty Jones at 3-5. And a reminder that Stuart Elliott had such a magical trip at the Derby, as you look at the Lionheart inside the paddock, not being saddled out on the turf course in front of the stands, but underneath the stands in the paddock, the normal paddock that's in use day in, day out here at Pimlico. Second in the Derby. A courageous second in the Derby, we might add. There are the other horses. They're out on the turf course in front of the stands where all can see. This unnerves them sometimes. Kenny Rice.
Tom Patrick Biancone told me that the reason he brought Lionheart in here is Lionheart is a pro. He has traveled and traveled well in his career, but he just basically wanted to keep him out of the heat. That's why he had the wet cloth on his head when he was coming over, and I think maybe Patrick himself would like to stand out of the heat a little bit in here, even though it is quite a bit muggy. But Lionheart's very professional being saddled up here, the only horse in the inside paddock here, Tom.
All right, Kenny, and starting to walk around the walking ring there, and back in the jockey's room, getting ready to make their way over to the turf course for final instructions. Stuart Elliott, we said that really the only bad moment of his Derby experience, his first ever Derby experience, fined $1,000 by the Kentucky Racing Authority because on his jockey application before the Derby, he failed to indicate they had entered a guilty plea to a charge of aggravated assault a few years earlier. That was the only bad moment in a magical week in Kentucky for Stuart Elliott. Elliott and the other riders making their way out, and still popular amongst all these people as he makes his way down through the crowd.
Thank you.
All right, well, Smarty Jones, the fans see him as the overwhelming favorite here. You hear some applause behind us, by the way, as they see the jockeys make their way down the steps. Mike Smith there, Jerry Bailey. And let's go to our handicappers, Mike and Bob.
Well, fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. Lionheart was my pick in the Derby, ran well, a good second. But if there's any room on the Smarty bandwagon, can you pencil me in about a little square foot that I can jump on? I mean, the price is ridiculous, Mike, but we got to be on him.
It really is, and I'm on the bandwagon, too. And, you know, he's won 7 in a row. And while I don't think you can call him a great horse yet, I think he has the capabilities of being a great horse. And the reason I say this is that Smarty Jones doesn't need any help to win his races. Take a look at the Arkansas Derby. In the Arkansas Derby, he breaks from the outside post. There's not a lot of speed in here. Look at Stuart Elliott. He has to gun this horse. He really uses this horse early on because he knows there's not a lot of speed inside. There's a horse named Purge in here. He had to go out and run with him, and he does it. He actually gets in front before they get to the first turn. I thought he was a speed horse. That's why I didn't think he could win the Kentucky Derby. Look at him here in the Derby. Pace is a little bit quicker. There's horses all around him. Stuart Elliott just takes hold of the horse. He keeps his position, holds his position great, but he doesn't feel the need to gun this horse and go up after the early lead. He's content to sit back behind, and that's what I mean when I say doesn't need any help. If the pace is slow, he's going to go out there. If the pace is fast, he can sit back off of that pace.
And the stretch drive in the Derby was marvelous, wasn't it? Lionheart and Smarty, eyeball to eyeball as they turned for home, and it was memorable indeed, and I think that some people believe that they can run this exacta right back 1-2. I don't know. It's a deep track, and that play against Lionheart in this race, Mike. I don't think there's any question about that.
The late runners are running much better than the early speed is right now at this point in time.
And people want to talk about the new faces. We mentioned Eddington at the top of the broadcast, but I think Rock Hard 10 deserves a good look for that nice run in the Santa Anita Derby. I mean, he's a beautifully bred horse, lightly raced, only 3 races. We're going to look at the stretch drive here at Churchill. This was 2 weeks ago, and Lionheart is cooked by then. And this gave Smarty, believe it or not, 7 wins at 7 different distances at 4 different racetracks. If he wins today, that'll be 8 different distances. So, how can you play against him?
You really can't. I cannot pick against this horse, even at 3-5. I don't have any trouble picking him. I just hate picking the same horse you pick.
Well, hey, listen. Last year, I was lucky enough to pick the exacta with $12 of fun. This year, I'm going with 8 is enough. $8 is enough, and that is the exacta box of Smarty and Rock Hard 10, the exacta box of Smarty and Longshot Perego, and let's see if we can hit this thing for $8.
I kind of think Imperialism is going to run big. I think that the way this track's playing, I already mentioned that the early runners were not faring too well. Imperialism will be flying at the end. That's my exacta. Smarty and Imperialism.
2 votes for Smarty Jones, Tom Hammond.
All right, guys, there's a look at Imperialism. And Imperialism, we're told, lost a shoe on the way over. And they have a blacksmith standing by, and he will have to be reshod. They'll delay things until we get Imperialism all squared away. Hope he wasn't stable next to the cliff's edge. That sort of a losing shoes thing is contagious. Well, if Smarty Jones had any idea what he had to carry, both Mike and Bob today, he couldn't do it. But I have to add to the problems, because I don't see anybody else I could pick either. I have to pick Smarty Jones as well. I underestimated him before the Derby. He convinced me with his run there. What about you?
Well, I think Smarty Jones is absolutely the horse to beat. He's done nothing wrong. How can you go against him? But just for fun, let's look for something that's a little bit more of a price. We've got a horse here with absolute raw talent. We don't really know a lot about him. Rock Hard 10. To win this race off of only three prior starts, he'd have to be a super horse. But there are a lot of people who think he might be. He broke his maiden the same day that Imperialism won the San Vicente, going the same distance, and he did it in exactly the same time.
Now, are you picking Rock Hard 10 or Smarty Jones?
Well, I'm picking it. Neumeier got a he got an exacta ticket. Can I have a ticket to go both ways?
But who on top? Who's on top?
We'll put Smarty on top, and we'll Rock Hard 10 on bottom.
It was a struggle. Maybe I can get a straight answer from Bob.
Well, Tom, you have tapped into a very shallow well of expertise when you turn to me for a pick. Smarty Jones, though, is too easy. I've been talking to some of the wise guys. They tell me this is a good day for a closer. Therefore, I'm picking Imperialism or Mariano Rivera, one or the other. And if you don't like it, take it up with this guy over here. Tom?
All right, Kenny Rice.
Hey, Tom. I'm here with Kristen Mulhall. Imperialism is being shooed right now. We're back in the indoor paddock. What happened out there, Kristen?
He was walking around in a circle, and he grabbed a hold of his shoe and just sprung it right off. So we're just packing it back on really quick.
Well, he seems to be standing calm. It's the left front?
Yeah, it's the left front. He's very calm. He's taking it all easy.
Okay, good luck.
Thank you.
All right, Tom, we continue to wait here while the blacksmith's doing his job. You see Kristen Mulhall is very calm. I do think that as far as a pick today, I'm going to stick with Lionheart. I know I'm going against the grain, that speed will hold up on a track that's been a little deeper than usual, but the horse has been there in every single race. I think this is the day that he gets there.
All right, so a pick for Lionheart, a contrarian in our midst. Log on to NBCSports.com to make your selection. Patrick Biancone, he'll be saddling Lionheart today. Right now, things held up a moment while they re-put the shoe on Imperialism. We're back at Pimlico. There's a live shot of Imperialism, who is coming back out on the track. Just a few moments ago, when he was inside, the blacksmith was reapplying a shoe to his left front foot. Earlier, walking in a circle, he had stepped on the shoe with his back foot, prying it off, and now it's being reapplied. Let's go to Mike Battaglia.
And Nick Zito knows what it's like for a horse to lose a shoe. It's easy for a horse to throw a shoe. It happened at a good time for Imperialism.
Yeah, I'm glad that Kristen had a chance to put it back on right now. And she handles herself well. I just told my assistants she does a good job.
And what about the cliff's edge? Can he be ready for the Belmont?
It looks that way, Mike. I mean, right now, what I saw this afternoon, but we keep our fingers crossed, because you know those things are day to day, minute to minute. I hope so.
And Sir Shackleton's looking great. Good luck to you in this race, Nick. Tom?
All right, Mike. Sir Shackleton is number six, owned by Tracy Farmer, trained by Nick Zito, and Royal Assault won the Sir Barton Stakes early on the card for them. There's a look at Chappie Chapman and Pat Chapman, the owners of Smarty Jones. Remember Chappie with emphysema, confined to his wheelchair. And there's Smarty Jones. Kent DeSormo now talking to Kristen Mulhall. He's the rider of Imperialism, who had the shoe reapplied. Patrick Biancone has to be worrying about this racing surface at Pimlico, which has been very tiring for the speed horses the last couple of days. Yesterday, even worse than today, perhaps. Bob Neumeier.
Kristen Mulhall, can you tell us what happened?
He was just walking around out here, and he stepped on a shoe and yanked it off, so we just had to tack a new one on.
Good as new?
As good as new.
All right, good luck, Kent.
That's a cheap way to get free shoes, huh?
Sormo and Kristen Mulhall nervously awaiting Imperialism. Riders up shortly.
All right, Paddock Judge Shane Burke giving the call of riders up here for the 129th Preakness. And as the riders mount, we'll have the call to the post by the bugler, and then the singing of Maryland, My Maryland.
Go,
Thank you,
buddy. All right. Always a pleasure.
Try to hurry back here.
Ladies and gentlemen.
That's the idea.
Good enough. He was a prince.
All right,
good luck.
Good to see you, huh?
Yeah.
Waiting for the riders up on there, Smarty
now
Jones.
Now assembled in the infield winner's circle is the U.S. Naval Academy Barbershop Quartet, who will sing Maryland, My Maryland.
Thou wilt not cower in the dust, Maryland, my Maryland. Thy gleaming sword will never rust, Maryland, my Maryland. Remember Carol's sacred trust, remember slumbers with the just, Maryland, my Maryland.
And the horses on the track for the 129th running of the Preakness Stakes, $1 million guaranteed for three-year-olds at a distance of a mile and 3/16, a 16th of a mile shorter than the Kentucky Derby. Pat Chapman in anticipation as the horses begin their post-parade for this race. There's Eddington making his way out under Jerry Bailey, who had to pass on a Derby ride when Wimbledon, his mount, was scratched by Bob Baffert in a couple of days before the race. And number one is Lionheart, a $1.4 million two-year-old, and he won all three of his races last year at two, and this year in three races, he's finished second each time, including second by 2 3/4 lengths to Smarty Jones in the Derby. Mike Smith aboard Lionheart. Number two, Borrego. That means horns in Spanish. He has a couple of calcium deposits on his head that kind of look like horns. You know, he won't even officially be 3 years old until 2 days from now. Foaled on May 17th. Sebo Greeley is the part breeder, part owner, and the trainer of Borrego, who was 10th in the Derby. Little Math Man, a long shot, is the three horse. Like Smarty Jones, based at Philadelphia Park. Like Funnyside in New York, bred, displaced his pallet in the Wood Memorial his last start when he finished 7th. The Cliff's Edge, the 4, was scratched. 5 is Song of the Sword under Jorge Chavez. Jennifer Peterson, the trainer. In fact, there are three female trainers today in the Preakness. First time that's ever happened. In the Derby, Song of the Sword ran 11th at 56-1. Sir Shackleton, named for Sir Ernest Shackleton, the British explorer. In 1914, his ship Endurance was frozen solid in the Antarctic for 10 months. He took an open boat 800 miles to safety. They hope Sir Shackleton can do the same. First trip around two turns, he won the Derby trial. Rafael Bejarano leads the nation in wins. There's Smarty Jones. You know the story by now. 7-4-7, trying to join Seattle Slew and Majestic Prince as the only horses to ever win both the Derby and the Preakness while undefeated. Number 8, Imperialism, who had the shoe replaced a few moments ago. Seems like bad luck is following Imperialism around these days after the tough trip in the Derby where he ran 3rd. He's the most experienced horse in the field. This will be his 17th start, 3rd in the Derby. One time he ran in a maiden claiming race, but young 21-year-old Kristen Mulhall has done a wonderful job with him. Number 9 is Eddington under Jerry Bailey. Eddington in the Wood Memorial ran 3rd, as we showed you earlier. Mark Hennig is the trainer of Eddington. Number 10 is Rock Hard 10. Madeline Paulson, one of the owners, said he was so beautiful. If a man can be a 10, he's a Rock Hard 10. He is beautiful. Huge horse. He's only had 3 starts, and he's had 6 weeks since his last one, the Santa Anita Derby, when he ran under the wire 2nd, but was disqualified for 3rd. He's won 2 of his lifetime 3 races. And number 11 is the home team, Water Cannon. Since trainer Linda Albert put the blinkers on him, he's been unbeaten. His first 6 starts, he didn't win a race. His last 5 with the blinkers, he's won them all, including the Tessio Stakes over this Pimlico track, the only horse that has a winning ride over this racetrack. And that's the field for the 129th running of the Preakness Stakes. Smarty Jones carrying the hopes of the Philly faithful in the Preakness.
Philly's a tough town.
Did you get a sausage?
Philly loves an underdog. Philly just loves that kind of winner, and he's a winner.
We are the city of champions, but this seems like we're due.
We're not used to winning that much.
Really hope he wins the Preakness. Wouldn't that be great?
He looks like he can really do it.
We have a triple crown possibility in Philadelphia. I mean, who would have thunk that?
Smarty Jones, Smarty Jones, yeah. Since the day he was bred, all they ever said was Smarty Jones, Smarty Jones. This colt made some dough by winning six in a row. John Service said to Stewie, just sit and let him roll. There was a roar from the crowd, you couldn't hear a sound, so they laid their money down. Now they're looking for the crown. Smarty Jones, ooh, yeah. Smarty Jones, yeah, yeah. Since the day he was bred, all they ever said was Smarty Jones.
Thank you.
Bob Costas back at Pimlico, just minutes away now from the 129th running of the Preakness Stakes. As has been noted, there has been no Triple Crown winner since Affirmed in 1978, and it appears that the public is jonesing for another chance. Five of the last 7 years, including the last two, and last year with Funny Side, a horse has in fact won the Derby and the Preakness, only to come up short in the Belmont. Will it be six of eight? Will Smarty Jones put himself in that position and then look to the Belmont 3 weeks hence? We'll find out shortly, but the public believes in him. He's a 3-5 right now. Back upstairs to Tom and Charleston.
All right, Bob, thank you very much. There is Smarty Jones. Looks quiet and composed right now. The odds, as you see, 3-5 on Smarty Jones. There are actually three horses vying for second favorite at 6-1. Lionheart, Imperialism, and Rockhard 10 all at 6-1 on the board behind the favorite Smarty Jones, who also was the favorite in the Kentucky Derby, where they bet overwhelmingly on Smarty Jones at Philadelphia Park that day, as they did at Oaklawn Park, where Smarty had won the Arkansas Derby. Look at that. The party is underway. They just hope it continues for a while longer if their favorite can get home today in the Preakness. And trainer John Service, again, probably feeling the butterflies, talking to Chappie. You remember that that moment after the Derby when Chappie Chapman raised his arms above his head and then had to sit down to get his breath, as he said. He only has about 20% function in his lungs due to emphysema, has an oxygen bottle always nearby, and he was, as he said, nearly overcome as he watched his horse win the Kentucky Derby.
The Chapmans have been involved in steeplechasing before now, and they're probably the only people in the world who can claim to have won the Maryland Hunt Cup and the Kentucky Derby.
Well,
what
like
a double.
To, like to add the Preakness from the Maryland connections
exactly.
As well.
And a good chance look at Smarty. He's such a cool, calm professional. Here's a horse who's never run the same distance twice. And he doesn't have to carry his racetrack around with him. He proved that in Kentucky when we ran over that gooey track. And this is the fifth state he's competed in. Whatever the question is, he seems to have the answer.
John Service saying after that accident in the gate, that terrible accident where he fractured his skull, he has been very professional, much more mature. Well, there's one of the new horses with Jerry Bailey aboard, Eddington.
Well, he sort of harkens back to Red Bullet, if you remember the horse who put the stops on Fusaichi Pegasus. There are a lot of eerie similarities. They're both by unbridled. They both have the almost identically same race records. They started in New York, campaigned in Florida, went to the Gotham Wood. They came here under Jerry Bailey, and of course, Eddington hopes to be just like Red Bullet and being the spoiler on another Derby-winning favorite here at the Preakness.
And, of course, when we were making our selections, Donna Brothers didn't get a chance to make hers. Donna, who do you like in the Preakness?
Well, Tom, you can count me in on the Smarty party. I just can't see any reason why this horse can't win this race again. I realize they say speed hasn't been holding, but I think Smarty Jones has shown that he can come from off the pace, and he might have to in this race. But count me in, Tom. I'm in the Smarty party.
All right. Donna, now let me ask you about the track, because the speed horses have struggled both yesterday and to a lesser extent today. What are the jockeys telling you about the condition of the track and how it might affect the front runners, thinking of Lionheart, Sir Shackleton, and Smarty Jones in particular?
Well, I did talk to Mike Smith earlier because, as we mentioned, he is the controlling speed of the race, and he said the only horses that have won on the lead in the last couple of days have gone in 25 for the first quarter. Lionheart's never gone in 25 for the first quarter, but he's a runner, and a lot of times runners overcome track biases, but certainly it has favored the horses that come from just off the pace because speed doesn't seem to be holding if it goes very fast, Tom.
Well, there's Lionheart in the number one post. And only one horse from the number one post has won the Preakness in the last 43 years.
Patrick Biancombe said an interesting thing after the Kentucky Derby. He saw the race today. The Preakness is a rematch between Smarty Jones and Lionheart. He said the winner would be the horse who came out of the Kentucky Derby the best. Lionheart has certainly looked well here, but John Service feels that Smarty Jones is pretty much at his best. He said he might be a notch below where he was before the Kentucky Derby. He feels that Smarty is vulnerable today. He said all three top three finishers in the Kentucky Derby could be a little vulnerable today after that effort.
There's Smarty, and of course we saw Imperialism lose a shoe earlier. And Kristen Mulhall stood by while the blacksmith reapplied the shoe. How much might that hurt or not at all?
Well, you certainly don't want to have it happen. And actually, Kristen had an unpleasant experience recently where a paddock blacksmith tacked a shoe back on down in Kentucky, and he got it with a high nail, and the horse was a little lame and didn't run well. So it's not what you want to see happen, to have a strange blacksmith shoeing your horse, and you certainly don't want it happening before a Grade 1 Classic.
And, of course, proceedings were delayed a bit by that Imperialism losing his shoe, and so they want to give him ample time to warm up before the race is run. So things running a little bit behind schedule because of the delay to reshoe Imperialism.
Well, we're looking here at Imperialism, and he wouldn't even be here if it hadn't been for the extreme pressure Kent DeSormo put on. He knows Pimlico well. He's five times been leading rider here. His career started here in Maryland, and he guaranteed both Kristen and owner Steve Paub if they would bring Imperialism here to Pimlico, he would win the next two legs of the Triple Crown. So he's got a lot riding on today.
One of the new horses, of course, Rock Hard 10, the very inexperienced horse, and he is an eyeful, Charlie. We'll get a shot of Rock Hard 10 here in a moment as we continue to track Imperialism there in his final warm-ups. But Rock Hard 10, as they make their way now, lining up to come to the starting gate.
Rock is a
picture book.
Oh, he's a gorgeous horse. He's huge, and he's a good mover, and he's just beautiful. And as we've said, he's just a bundle of talent. Many horsemen in California said he was the best of the crop, and obviously he didn't get much of a chance to go. But Rock Hard 10 and Eddington both are huge, big, gorgeous horses who trained most impressively here this week.
And Smarty Jones now at 3-5. You mentioned Red Bullet passing the Derby and then beating Fusaichi Pegasus, who was a big favorite here in 2000. Lionheart now is the second choice at 5-1, and he is the first to load. There he is, number one, under Mike Smith, Lionheart, and his trainer, Patrick Biancombe. And number two will go in. That's Borrego, trying to improve on his 10th place finish at Churchill Downs. The three horses, Little Math Man, outsider, but based at Philadelphia Park, trying to catch a little of that magic.
He had a little breathing problem in the Wood Memorial and should bounce back to his good form going around two turns.
Song of the Sword, sort of a surprise entry after a poor run at Churchill Downs, thinking he didn't like the track. There's the horse of the hour, Smarty Jones, going in, trying to go 8-for-8 and head to the Belmont for the Visa Triple Crown. Can he do it? John Service, Pat Chapman, Chappy Chapman hope so. Imperialism goes in. Total of 10 with the scratching of the cliff's edge. 1 3/16, the 129th Preakness to give you the call. Let's go to Tom Durkin.
And the final horses moving into line. There is the local hero, Water Cannon, the only horse ever to race over the Pimlico track. Indeed, he won over the Pimlico track. Nonetheless, he is 35-1. As they take their place in the starting gate. Rock Hard 10, just a little reluctant to move into the starting gate. This might be the biggest Preakness field I've ever called. No, not in numbers. I mean, there's just 10, but there are some big horses in there. And Rock Hard 10, the biggest of them all. He's a big old boy. And there's some other big horses in there as well as Borrego and Eddington. And Rock Hard 10, giving the assistant starters a little trouble. They're being a little gentle with him right now. They don't want to get too concerned. The head man here at the starting gate is Bruce Wagner, starting his second Preakness Stakes. There's Rock Hard 10 and Gary Stevens. Hopes he gets in the gate pretty quickly because he's got a plane to catch here pretty soon. They're backing Imperialism out of the gate. And now he moves back into his post position, number 8. As far as tactics go here, well, Lionheart, he'd love to get to that lead. The first quarter mile here is very key at Pimlico. They've got a quarter mile run into the turn. And now they've opened up the stall, the front gates of the starting stall. Sometimes that will give horses a little more confidence to move into the starting gate. Donna's out there, and Donna, what do you get from your horse side view?
Well, as you mentioned, Tom, Rock Hard 10 has been a little reluctant to load. They do have a shank over his nose, and they try to open the front doors, as you mentioned, but he still was reluctant to load.
They do what they call a lock and load, where the starters will join hands behind a horse's rear end and try to push him into the gate. But Rock Hard 10 has kicked every single time they've tried to do that. Now Gary Stevens is dismounted, and I think they're going to try to load Rock Hard 10 without the rider on and maybe have a little bit more luck.
These horses, the assistant starters, they really have to be more psychologists than strongmen here, because especially Rock Hard 10, this horse probably weighs about 1,200 pounds.
No.
And if he does not want to go in, they're going to have a real difficult time doing it. But now they're going to resort to some physical force to move him in the starting gate, pushing, pulling, about five guys taking to do it. The other horses are standing in remarkably good order, and with a little oomph from assistant starters, they are in the gate. Now a water cannon will have to move into line, and we'll be ready for the start, finally, the 129th Preakness Stakes. They are in the gate. And they're off. Smarty Jones gets off to a good beginning. Little Math Man was shuffled back. So too was Sir Shackleton. Lionheart down toward the inside. Smarty Jones comes away with an early lead. But there goes Lionheart with his typical early tack. And Mike Smith is angling him out as they head for the clubhouse turn, forcing Smarty Jones a little out into the track. Uncharacteristic speed from Imperialism, who's right up on the pace today. He's running third as they move into the clubhouse turn, but he's very wide. Smith really taking them out there into the track. Song of the Sword saves ground all the way. He's running along in fourth. Sir Shackleton, shuffled back early, is fifth. Eddington, sixth in and among horses. Rock Hard 10 is under a hard hold early. Four wide round the clubhouse turn. And down toward the inside, it is Borrego. Water Cannon at the back of the pack today. And Little Math Man. 23-3 for the opening quarter. And Lionheart is loose on the lead down the backstretch run. 47-1 over the deep track at Pimlico today for the opening half mile. So it is Lionheart in front. And the Derby winner, Smarty Jones, runs along in second. Jorge Chavez moving early with Song of the Sword with five furlongs to go. They're running along in third. Imperialism is in the clear on the far outside. He's fourth. Sir Shackleton is fifth. Jerry Bailey wants more from Eddington. He's not getting it yet. And there goes Rock Hard 10, who rolls up on the outside and around the far turn. Mike Smith is giving Smarty Jones the rail. He remains well off the rail with three furlongs to go on Lionheart. An inviting opening on the inside for Smarty Jones. And Rock Hard 10 is uncoiling that massive stride of his. He is third as they come to the top of the stretch. And as they hit the top of the stretch, Smarty Jones has taken the lead. It is Smarty Jones in front. Lionheart doing his best, but he's second. Rock Hard 10 is third as they come into the final furlong of the 129th Preakness. And it is Smarty Jones. He's pulling away. He's pulling away to win impressively here. Rock Hard 10 second on the inside. He's going to win by a colossal margin. Here is Smarty Jones. He wins the Preakness by a dozen lengths. He remains undefeated. And it's on to Belmont. This Philadelphia story continues its magical way to the elusive Triple Crown. Rock Hard 10 was second. It was close for third. The final time was 1:55.25. This is special.
Oh, did he ever do it? Smarty Jones, the Philly Flyer, turned the Preakness into a runaway. No problem. Stuart Elliott said, let's go, big fella. And they rolled home to win the Preakness and now set sail for Belmont Park and the Belmont Stakes and a chance for racing history as 3 weeks from now, hopefully they'll take to the gates for the Belmont Stakes. Wow, Smarty Jones and Stuart Elliott devastating the field. Donna Brothers is riding his normal pony, Butterscotch. That's the horse that goes with Smarty Jones to the track every day. He looks like he's happy too, Donna.
Stuart, this was an amazing performance by Smarty Jones today. Tell me about it.
He's just unbelievable. He just keeps getting better, this son of a gun. I mean, he just did it so easy.
So tell me about that. Well, it looks like as he's gotten older, he rates better, he does everything you ask him to do better. Is he getting better or more mature or both?
I think a little bit of everything. He's just figuring everything out. He's learned to settle, and he's just really getting it together.
Stuart, all day long, Speed has been having trouble on this track. You laid second in the race. Did you ride your race to accommodate the track or the horse?
Well, you know, I was a little bit concerned about the track, but my horse has his way of running, and I didn't want to drag him back. I just rode him with confidence, and he did the running. He just galloped.
Speaking of confidence, in the Derby you went around Lionheart. Today you decided to jump to the inside of him. What prompted that decision?
Well, in the Derby I see Mike having trouble, and he was able to get him back. When he didn't get him back around the first turn, I figured he might never get him back. So I cut to the inside. There was plenty of room. So I figured I'd save some ground just in case anybody was coming on.
Stuart, did you give a little portion of the $5 million bonus after the Kentucky Derby? And if you did, what are you going to do with it?
I'm going to save it for when if I get old.
I don't think that's going to happen. Doesn't look like Smarty Jones is going to get old either. Congratulations, Stuart. We go to Kenny Rice.
Mr. and Mrs. Chapman are now making their way to the escalator. Worked out a game plan. If Smarty Jones had won, he would come straight back. The Chapmans would, and Mr. Chapman right now will be helped out of the wheelchair and to the escalator. He will be taken down through the indoor paddock because it is flat, and then from there he'll go on over to the ramp that's being laid across the track. Just as he said he would not do at the Kentucky Derby, he would not allow his wheelchair to be carried the track, and he said it's the same way here. So Mr. and Mrs. Chapman are on their way now to the winner's circle. Tom?
All right, Kenny, there he is, Smarty Jones, the 29th horse to win the Derby and Preakness. Only 11 have completed the Triple Crown. And, of course, Smarty Jones, the first undefeated Derby and Preakness winner since Seattle Slew. In fact, Smarty Jones only the third to do that. Seattle Slew and Majestic Prince, and now Smarty Jones. Chappie continues his progress. Now back into the wheelchair. Had his 78th birthday just 3 days after the Kentucky Derby.
Was I getting service?
John Service with his stable foreman Bill Foster. Mike?
Where's John?
Well, Mike's calling for John, and he's John Service surrounded by well-wishers at the moment. And I hear a chant of Smarty, Smarty from some here. Smarty Jones, the sixth winning favorite, the first odds-on winner since Spectacular Bid was 1-10 in 1979. Affirmed, who of course took the Belmont to complete the Triple Crown the last time we've had one in 78, won the Preakness at 9-10. Let's go bound to Mike now.
John Service, Smarty Jones' win in the Derby was amazing. His win in the Preakness was electrifying. I got goosebumps watching it. That is unbelievable.
I got goosebumps myself, Mike. I'm really, really happy with him.
Can you believe the way he just exploded down the stretch?
Well, you know, I was a little concerned about the 2 weeks, and we elected not to work him. And, you know, I think it was a good move. He was real sharp leaving the gate, and Mike did a real good job of trying to keep controlling him all the way around the turn down the backside. And Stewie did a great job of just following Mike and waiting for his chance. And Mike tried to park him a little bit. He went to the inside, and he went on about his business.
How great is this horse?
This horse is great. This jock's pretty doggone good, too.
And you did a heck of a job training.
Well, thank you very much, Mike.
You just got to be on cloud nine.
I'm on cloud nine.
We're with you.
Thank you, buddy.
All right, John.
Thank you.
John Service.
All right, Mike, and there's a look at Pete Van Trump, who gallops him in the mornings. The groom, Mario Arriaga. And the connections of Smarty Jones. They'll leave Stuart Elliott in the saddle and walk him a bit until Chappie Chapman can make it over to the winner's circle. He doesn't want to miss the presentation. And the Visa Triple Crown once again in sight after the Derby and Preakness. But with a twist this time, because the horse that is aiming for the Triple Crown is 8-4-8. Bob Neumeier.
Well, thanks, Tom. With runner-up jockey Gary Stevens aboard Rock Hard 10 and pace setter Mike Smith. Mike, let me start with you. Did you try to float this horse wide into the first turn?
Well, he always floats out. You know, that's just to get him to rate, you gotta let him a little bit. Otherwise, if you grab a hold of him to pull him in, he grabs a bit. He was struggling early on. It made him get out even more than usual. And Smarty Jones, man, he's just an amazing horse. Like we was talking earlier, I think me and Gary on some great colts. We're just born in the wrong year.
All right, Mike, let's go to Gary now. Rock Hard 10 had trouble loading. You seemed very, very wide throughout. Was that a problem?
No, it wasn't a problem at all. I mean, I finished second. I had some problems at the starting gate. I'm sure took a little bit of something out of him. But I was happy out in the middle of the track. The going was good, and I was actually placed right behind the winner throughout the trip. He was wide also. But I was absolutely no match for the winner. He's something very, very special. We might have seen some history in the making right here. I thought I had a chance right here coming into the stretch. And
yeah, you got some positive momentum coming here. You got to think you got a chance here.
Great momentum, and I had another gear left. Unfortunately, when I hit the other gear, Smarty Jones hit about four more gears, and Mike Colt knew it was over with right here, and I'm just basically running for second. Smarty Jones looks like he's just getting warmed up right here at the finish, and I'm pretty excited for them. I would have loved to have won it, but my horse, he's young. He's got a great future ahead of him, and like Mike said, we might have just been born in the wrong year to come up against Smarty Jones.
All right, Gary, thank you very much. Let's go back to Tom.
All right, Bob, and the Preakness is now official. Smarty Jones being led into the winner's circle. Here are the payouts. Smarty Jones, $340, $3, $260. Rockhart, $10, $5, and $4. Eddington got the show spot, $520. The Exacta paid $24.60. The Try, $177. And the Superfecta, $230. He's the little horse that could. Pennsylvania bred from Philadelphia Park. One for the little guys. And Smarty Jones becomes only the third horse in history to win both the Derby and Preakness with an undefeated record. He'll head to the Belmont Stakes having won eight races in eight starts. Stuart Elliott sneaking a peek under his shoulder there. And Charlsey, at this point, he's not taking any chances, but he doesn't see anybody else.
You know, it's interesting. John Service said that he was still learning before the Derby. It looks to me like he's done gone to graduate school here. He's got his PhD. Look at his ears. How easy did he do this?
He took them all to school today. And at Philadelphia Park. Well, you know how tough those Philly fans can be, but they love this horse, and look at the man who's done such a remarkable job, John Service. His wife, Sherry, the Chapmans. What a story. Remarkable. And a look at Smarty Jones, his colors being painted on the weather vane atop the cupola, and joined now by Shane Sellers. Shane, of course, lost his Preakness ride when the Cliff's Edge was scratched, but he's here to help us with our Computer Associates race replay. Welcome, Shane.
Thank you.
And Smarty Jones certainly has everybody talking now. Let's take a look at this replay now and watch him isolated from start to finish. Clear break for him, even though a couple of horses did get squeezed in there.
Yeah, he's a good gate horse. You can tell that, and he got off really good. And Stewart just rode an impeccable race. I mean, he sat chilly. He's looking around right now, and right here you can see Mike's. He's clocking Mike's horse right here because Mike's having trouble. And you know, Mike, you could tell Mike went a little far out right here, but he's looking to get inside or outside, but he's holding his ground, and he just rode a fantastic race.
Lionheart has that tendency to drift out around both turns. All of the riders are fully aware of it, and Stewart sits there and just trails along behind him. Look at him. He's got plenty of horse here, and Smarty relaxes so professionally.
What he's doing right here, he's watching Mike, but at the same time, he's looking on the inside and on the outside, not letting nobody push him down in there and force him to do anything. As you can see, he keeps looking over his right shoulder, his left shoulder, but at the same time, he's clocking Mike, and he's not going to let Mike get away. And right here, he's going to look at Mike, and I think he can tell that Mike's going to have trouble in the next turn, and he does a great job right here. He does a great move and pushes him to the inside.
Well, he's got Song of the Sword up inside him. Did you think he was going to have room to drop over and go to the inside of Lionheart?
Well, right there, you could tell. I mean, he had to make a decision, so he made sure he cleared the horse on the inside of him. Right here, you can tell that he knows he's got this. He got Lionheart at bay.
This is what's so impressive about Smarty Jones. He can give you that burst of tactical speed whenever you need it.
He can. This is a great horse. I mean, we might be looking at the next Triple Crown winner. It doesn't look like and you can see Stewart right here. This has got to be a great feeling for him. You know, oh man, I'm so happy for him. He's a great guy.
This is a great burst of acceleration through the stretch, but Shane, if the Cliff's Edge, the mount that you lost today, if he is well by Belmont time, can he chase Smarty Jones effectively?
Well, you know, it's something that it depends on how much time he's going to lose or how much this is going to take out of Smarty Jones. But this is a tough-looking horse, and we'll just have to see.
All right. Thank you, Shane. Shane Sellers helping us with our Computer Associates race replay. And you notice, all alone at the finish, Smarty Jones going back for a well-deserved bath. Here's the official order of finish in the Preakness. Smarty Jones wins by 7 3/4 lengths, the official margin, the largest margin in the history, 129 years of the Preakness. Now to Bob Costas for the presentation.
All right, Tom, on the very crowded victory stand, Tim Smith, the commissioner of the NTRA and the president and CEO of Visa USA, Carl Pasquarella. And now Smarty Jones moves to within one big victory at the Belmont of collecting the $5 million that's been out there for almost a decade.
That's right, Bob. First, I want to congratulate the Chapmans and John and Stewart. It was a great race. I think we have the real deal. He's one race away from being the all-time money winner and one race from being the undefeated thoroughbred champion for the Triple Crown, the Visa Triple Crown, since Seattle Slew. So I think we've got the real deal here, and we can't wait at Visa to get that $5 million in their hands.
All right, Joe DeFrancis is the president of the Maryland Jockey Club and the chairman of the board of Magna Entertainment is Frank Stronach.
Well, first of all, I'd like to congratulate the winner and trainer in Chalky, and most of all, Smarty Jones for running a smart race. And the horse industry is very important to Maryland, and nobody realizes that more than our governor. And I'd like to thank the governor for his leadership and his commitment to the horse industry.
Governor Robert Ehrlich for the presentation.
Mr. Chapman, we in Maryland, we love the Preakness, and everybody loves Smarty today. Let me tell you something. Congratulations. We're very proud and very happy for you.
Roy and Pat Chapman, one of their grandchildren. You already picked up a $5 million one-time only bonus for winning the Rebel Stakes, the Arkansas Derby, and the Kentucky Derby, and now you could double it to $10 million with a win in the Belmont. How about this?
I got to talk to Smarty first, to tell you the truth.
All right, Mr. Chapman,
Marty said,
we'll let you confer with Smarty, and we'll send it over to Mike Battaglia.
Thanks, Bob. And you know what? Smarty Jones is truly America's horse now, John. Truly America's horse.
Well, he came through for America. I mean, I'm so impressed with his effort today. I really am. I knew he had to bring his best game. I knew it was the toughest race he's going to be in a long time, and he brought it. He brought it big time.
And I don't think anybody really realized how good this horse is, except maybe Stuart Elliott, who was sitting on him like he was sitting on Citation all the way around.
I tell you what, Mr. Service, last time you credited me, today I'm crediting you. I mean, he just took me around there. He's a great horse.
This has got to be, right now, one of the best feelings you've ever had in your entire life.
I can't even explain it. I really can't. I mean, I'm just so overwhelmed, and I'm happy for everybody. I really am. I mean, it's great. I love it.
On to the Belmont.
As long as he tells us he's ready, we're on to the Belmont.
3 weeks, we're going to see it, people. On to the Belmont for Smarty Jones. Congratulations, guys.
Thank you.
The Chapmans with a celebration after taking the second jewel in the Visa Triple Crown and doing it with a flourish. 7 3/4 lengths. Smarty Jones wins the Preakness Stakes and is still undefeated, the Philly Flyer. And with all the bad news in the world today, isn't it nice to smile about a story for a change? It's 3 weeks till the Belmont. Let's enjoy the ride. Tom Hammond, so long from Pimlico.